So there is not going to be any parking area to keep the other side of the farm, drive over, park, and then walk down the walkway?
There aren't any plans right now to create a new parking area there of any size.
We did look at places that you could take a parking space here or there. We felt that, given the nature of the roadway down there and the limited number of people who would be driving down there, that there's places along the existing Woods Road to park a couple of vehicles.
Mr. Parkhurst.
From time to time in the past, I have spent time at Hanson House, and I know how many cars go down and park in the parking lot there and then walk down to the beach. The idea of having this walkway and have no parking area doesn't seem to make sense to me. I've seen as many as 8 cars in that parking lot. People going down the beach for picnics, walks, what have you.
Well, there still will be parking at Hanson House, so some cars will go there, but we just weren't contemplating, you know, carving out a big parking area there. It's a fairly long access road along the Fern Trail, and there ought to be enough places along that trail to pull cars off to the side. And we'll see how it goes.
Following up that comment, if seeing how it goes, if it doesn't go well and you decide you want to come back for a parking area, will you have to come back before the planning board to create a parking area for cars to use the trail?
Well, we would do it in such a way that would be outside the resource protection area, so we wouldn't need a resource protection permit. I guess I would have to defer to Maureen to see if we need a site plan permit.
And just while she's looking that up, it seems to me the first set of plans that we received at some point in time showed a parking area.
That's true. I think the initial Sasaki plan that was developed as part of a year ago talked about a parking area down there. But, you know, like the rest of that plan, it's an evolutionary process. If there were to be any parking areas at all, it would probably just be a smooth area off the Woods Road. Certainly would not be paved at all.
I wouldn't expect it would be.
Is it wet? Is Fern Trail wet? Didn't I read that there were some wet spots?
This time of year, the non-beach-going times, yeah.
But in the summer when the beach was being used? Are there wet spots, I mean, on Fern Trail?
The Fern Trail, when Maureen and I went down over there for a site walk, was extremely wet. And in the spring, it is very wet. It's probably used by cross-country skiers in the winter and some horses in the spring. As summer comes along, we go down there, and we've actually have kept that road improved with gravel. It is passable at any time of year, for that matter. It's a very durable woods road. We take our full-size trucks down that road. We avoid it in the spring, although it is passable. And it is a decent road, woods road.
Okay.
And to follow up on that, I was on the road the night after, the day after the evening where we had 1.5 to 2 inches of rain. So when we were down there, it was probably as wet as you will ever see it. And there were a lot of puddles, but it was passable the entire way.
It has a very firm base, and yeah. We did not get stuck even in that case, which is one of the wettest times that of the year. In fact, the wettest I've ever seen that trail at that point in time.
But the only way we turned around is we went past the location where the boardwalk is going to be, and there was an area that had been logged, and there was an opening there where we were able to reverse direction. But I am curious to see where you put any parking.
I will point out that along that whole lower area, I believe the resource protection area would not allow us to have a parking area in that immediate vicinity of the trailhead. We would have to locate it down the road further away from that area, with the intention being, as Seth had said, of bicycles, foot traffic. But the ability is still there to put cars, a few cars along that road.
So would they have to come back for the port?
Well, the first thing is, in reviewing the ordinance, it's not clear to me that a parking lot is permitted use in the Residence A district. So I'm not sure they would even be able to come. I mean, you can't come back for site plan for review for something that's not even permitted. So, I mean, I have to go back to the code officer and see what his reading of the ordinance is, but right now it's not jumping out at me as something that you would even be allowed to do.
Wouldn't that be considered an accessory use, though, to a recreational use?
Well, potentially, yes. There are accessory, an athletic facility adjacent to a permitted use is permitted, and that's the only way I would see you coming in. But the way the ordinance is written, it says that the athletic facility is accessory to a permitted use. It doesn't say that a parking lot accessory to the athletic facility, which is also accessory to the permitted use. So I really would want to take this by the code officer and have him decide whether or not it's permitted. Assuming it is permitted, under the site plan regulations, if you are doing new construction, which I would consider parking new construction, of more than 10,000 square feet, then you would pass the threshold for site plan review, but I'm not sure if you were under that, whether you would need any kind of site plan review. Now, if you were doing anything in a resource protection district, you would automatically kick in the alteration provisions. But if you're just in a RA district and he could make the call that it's accessory, then I believe you'd be able to do it as long as it wasn't too many spaces.
Sounds reasonable.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I have a motion.
Please.
Motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, the Sprague Corporation has requested a resource protection permit to construct a boardwalk fern trail to Strawberry Beach, which requires a resource protection permit. Number two, the application was deemed complete at the March 17th, 1998 meeting of the Planning Board. Number three, the application substantially complies with the requirements of Section 19-3-3, resource protection permit. Therefore, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sprague Corporation for a resource protection permit to construct a boardwalk located between Fern Trail and Strawberry Beach be granted.
Mr. Wilcox, I'd like to second that motion.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
Just want to make one suggestion that, and that the last finding of fact, it's supposed to be Section 19-8-3.
Isn't that what I said?
No.
I thought I heard three.
I heard three also.
Oh, I'm sorry. Maybe I need stronger glasses.
I'll make bigger numbers.
Is there any discussion on the motion? None. Perhaps I can get one last question in for the applicant, which I was wondering. The final component of the proposed trail is a wood chip trail. Could you tell us a little bit about the wood chip trail also, or did I just
primarily to mark the way? Okay. There will be a certain amount of brush clearing. I think the intention is just to dispose of that on the surface.
Okay.
But for the most part, when we've gone through the woods here, we've kept to the higher and drier parts of the property. The intent, of course, is to make it as rusticated a trail as possible.
Even it out, sort of thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Any further discussion or questions? Well, I think we've covered quite a bit on this one. So, board members, considering approval for the motion, raise your right hand. A unanimous vote. Thank you very much. Don't go away.
Appreciate your comments about the glasses, Steve. I was noticing I cannot read my minutes anymore.
It's scary when they start to come.
I took what I had to say that I've enlarged it to 18 points.
The final item on our agenda this evening is the Sprague Master Plan Subdivision, a request by the Sprague Corporation for preliminary subdivision review of a 60-lot subdivision located south of Bowery Beach Road under Section 16-2-4, Preliminary Subdivision Review Completeness. If the applicant could step to the podium and give us an overview of the application, I think we can get going.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, Planning Board members. My name is Seth Sprague, and I'd like to thank you for your approval of our boardwalk plan. Here we go on to item number two. My name is Seth Sprague. I'm a vice president of the Sprague Corporation, and I'm here tonight again with John Green, our property manager, and Terry DeWan and Amy Bell of Terrence J. DeWan and Associates, our project managers, to introduce our plans for amending a part of our existing subdivision. I'd like to take a few minutes, if I might, to provide some background information and describe our plan's objectives and place the plan within a context. Finally, we would like to ask at the end of the evening, deem this preliminary application complete this evening and take up at the beginning of your review process four specific issues. They've been identified through work with the town staff and through the workshop process. Following my remarks, Terry DeWan will describe in more detail those issues and our proposed resolution of them. From the time that Phineas W. Sprague made his first land purchase in Cape Elizabeth in 1906, his purpose was to assemble property and preserve it for the future enjoyment of his family. In 1920, he formed the Sprague Corporation to hold the property that he was acquiring in Cape Elizabeth and in Scarborough. Today, the corporation holds approximately 2,100 acres in southwestern Cape Elizabeth. The size of our holdings has remained essentially unchanged for the past 50 years. Roughly described, the property includes the land
south of Barrowed Beach Road to the ocean, from the Spurwink River over to the western edge of Crescent Beach, by the sea, down to the ocean, and north of Bowery Beach Road, east of Fowler Road, and around Great Pond, and also Richmond Island. The Sprague Corporation, which owns the land, is owned by Black Point Corporation. Black Point Corporation, in turn, is owned by the heirs of P. Shaw Sprague, Phineas W. Sprague's son. Only the 42 heirs of Phineas Shaw Sprague may hold an ownership interest in the Black Point Corporation. Since the beginning of our ownership in 1906, the Sprague family has respected and protected the rural character of our land. In an effort to realize this goal in the future and balance it with the family's desire to enjoy the property by living here, we've created a family land use plan. We've worked on this project internally for several years. In addition to preserving the unique qualities of the property, our plan accommodates the potential housing needs of the family over the next several generations. Our family land use plan encompasses only the approximately 1,500 acres of the total property that are delineated on this map, bordered by Bowery Beach Road, Crescent Beach State Park, the ocean, and the Spurwink River. We are not making any changes in this plan in the use of our land north of Bowery Beach Road in the vicinity of Great Pond, nor to Richmond Island. The plan only applies to the land south of Bowery Beach Road. Within this area, 20 existing residences will have lots created around them. Only 40 new lots will be created. These 2 to 5 acre lots will be spread, as you see, around the entire 1,500 acres. Should family members desire to build in the future, they may select one of these from one of these sites. Our goal is to have lots approved now through the subdivision process so that all that would be required to build a home would be to apply for building permit. The Sprague Corporation will continue to own the property. Family members only will be able to lease these lots from the corporation. None of these lots will be for sale to the public. And we expect that any new building on the new lots to be created will occur gradually, and that it will be many years, if ever, before all of the 40 new sites are occupied. This plan will maintain the special character of the property while allowing a reasonable amount of growth within a controlled framework. We believe that Cape Elizabeth will benefit from the adoption of this plan. It will further the cooperative nature of our relationship with the town. It'll further the highest priority goal in the town's comprehensive plan, which is, and I quote, to preserve Cape Elizabeth's remaining rural character, end quote. In order to implement this family land use plan, we are applying for an amendment to our existing subdivision. Now, the applicable zoning and subdivision ordinances were not adopted by the town in contemplation of this kind of an application. Several items within these ordinances work against our common goal to preserve the distinct character of this property. The recurring problem in the following four areas that I'll mention is that the ordinances were essentially designed to regulate projects that are for sale to the public. Our plans provide for our private use of our own property. There will be no sales to the public. And we ask that you focus on that as you consider the following matters at the beginning of your review. The first item is open space. We're going to be asking that this requirement be waived as no deficiency of open space, which this section of the zoning ordinance was designed to address, is being created. Secondly, there's affordable housing. This is a requirement of the zoning ordinance, which was clearly intended to apply to commercial developments in which lots are offered for sale to the public. We request that you modify the requirements to permit our amendment without affordable housing, as this will not nullify the objectives of the comprehensive plan. We refer you to your town attorney's letter on this matter and on open space, in which he affirms your authority to make these decisions. Third item is road standards. The network of roads that we've maintained on the property has proved adequate for our needs and is integral to the overall character of the land. We are submitting plans here that upgrade the roads to the extent that seems prudent to meet emergency access requirements. There will be an emergency loop road that will give two means of access to all parts of the property that are contemplated for home sites. And our proposed road designs do not meet, however, the required 18-foot width standard in all areas, so as to avoid disturbing wetlands, removing significant trees, and irrevocably altering the character of the property. Our proposal does address the need to allow for passage of emergency vehicles. The final item is fire protection plans. Our application addresses the need to make improvements to our fire protection ponds. For a number of years, we have worked with the fire chief to establish a network of ponds with dry hydrants. And we are submitting plans, we have submitted plans to institute a regular maintenance program for the ponds. And in one case, we'll be designing a new hydrant location for installation when any new building occurs. In a number of locations, however, we're unable to provide a ready source of water for firefighting. We understand this risk, and we'll evaluate it on a case-by-case basis. This historic part of Cape Elizabeth has been the site of domestic settlement for over 350 years. The ability to fight fires here has never been better and will improve under the plans we're submitting. We ask that you not impose a fire protection standard that would prevent us from being able to utilize our property. I hope that after the introduction of our plans this evening, you'll be able to deem this preliminary application complete so that we can move ahead and discuss these issues and other ones without an undue delay. This is a big project, and it's going to take some time to get through it all. This family land use plan is just one of the many steps the Sprague Corporation is undertaking to assure its future. We want to continue to serve as stewards for this extraordinary property in the way we have for nearly a century. We sincerely hope that you will do what's within your capability to continue our mutually beneficial relationship. Thank you. And I'll turn it over to Terry.
Thank you, Spreth. Again, for the record, my name is Terry DeWan, a landscape architect in Yarmouth. As Seth said, this is a big project. When you look at 1,500 acres of land, you look at an existing subdivision, you look at 10 existing lots ranging in size from over 400 acres down to as small as 18 acres. You look at potential for 40 new houses out here, 20 new lots around existing houses. Yes, it can be a big subdivision, it can be a big project, but we'd like to take an opposite approach here and keep as a theme throughout the entire discussion that this is really the family's desire to do a long-term family plan that may stretch well beyond our lifetimes, that's not going to result in a great deal of change either to the physical or the visual environment that we're going to notice within our lifetime. It's easy to say that these are really 10 separate projects. In fact, there's many parts of our application that treat it as separate projects. We've summarized at the very end the various actions that are taking place on each of these 10 separate areas. But what we'd like to do tonight is to give you the proverbial overview to explain how the plan evolved. I know that at least half of you have heard this discussion before, but for the sake of the new members and to refresh the older members, we will give you a brief overview beyond what's in the application material. I'll explain a little bit more in detail about what's in the submission package. We would appreciate at some point about hopefully midway through our presentation to have some decision from the board as to whether or not this is a complete application. Given the time, we would like to continue on, hopefully once it is deemed complete, to start some of the substantive discussion about some of the issues, for example, roads and fire protection. So with that as an introduction, Mr. Chair, you have seen us before, of course. I think we've been before the board in four workshop sessions, and we've had one site walk with members of the board. Because there are new members, last time we were before the planning board, a month and a half ago in workshop session, we offered to bring any new members or any of the older members out to see the project once again, now that a lot of decisions have been made. As Seth indicated, the plan has gone through a lot of study, a lot of contemplation, both on the professional level and at the corporation level, talking among the family members. And the plan that you see here before you is basically the same plan that we presented before you when we first appeared in workshop session, but it has evolved an awful lot. The firm of Sasaki Associates from Watertown, Massachusetts was initially retained by the Sprague Corporation to do a master plan for what was called the core properties, these 1,470.7 acres of land that has been described as the area shown on the map between Bowery Beach, Crescent Beach State Park, the ocean, and the river. And they, as you saw earlier, developed a long-term plan based upon natural resource constraints and opportunities. There was a lot of study done on the soils that were in the area, some analysis done on the hydrology, an initial look at wetlands, a look at deer wintering areas, and so forth. And as a result of analysis maps, areas within each of the 10 larger lots were identified as possible sites for the individual family members to site homes over the next several generations. Those lots were indicated on the initial plans that you saw that we brought out to the field with us. If you recall, when we were in the field, we showed you the location of some of those house sites. We knew at the time that some of them need to be tweaked, some of them need to be altered, some of them need to be tossed out, some of them were moving lots around. But the end result was, as a result of additional study, a lot of additional conversation, A lot of additional work by Woodland Alternatives identifying the boundaries of the wetlands and the wetland buffers. The plan that you see before you is the one that we feel comfortable right now is the plan that we're ultimately going to proceed through the process of getting the family land use plan approved by the planning board. There has been a lot of soul searching on our parts, on the family's parts, to try and deal with the realities of dealing with the zoning ordinance. Things like minimum lot size, length of dead-end road, road frontage, and so forth have all been taken into consideration, and we feel, to the best of our ability, we've been able to meet the standards of the ordinance. This is not a cluster subdivision. We are not asking for any reduction of lot sizes. These are all lots that are a minimum of 80,000 square feet. As Seth indicated, the lots range in size from 2 acres up to about 5 acres in size. The average new lot is probably in the 2.5 to 3 acre size. We do present a chart showing the acreage and location of all the lots for your review. We have been dealing primarily with John Green and Seth Sprague in the development of the plan. However, they do speak for the family members. Every time we've come up with an examination of the earlier plans, John has brought it before the individual family members, and we've had a good dialogue that way. So we are very confident that the way the plan looks right now, with a few exceptions, I'm sure, is the way that we're ultimately going to be bringing before you for a final subdivision plan. What have we given you so far? I don't know if any of you have had a chance to look at the drawings. It was about 44 separate sheets of paper. I don't know if this sets a record or not for individual projects, but it certainly does in our book. It certainly beats the weight limit that we normally like to see in any one particular application. In addition to the drawings, which were done by BH2M engineers, who are the civil engineers and surveyors that we've been working with all along on the project, the basic information started with a 2-foot contour map of the developed area, and the entire area, I should really say. It was felt that since we are planning for the long-term use of the property, that the best thing that we could do, rather than pick out individual areas to have surveyed, was to have the entire area flown and a very good high-quality base map done. So we do have a 2-foot contour map over these 2.5 square miles of property. We've had the wetland delineation done. This time, rather than having the entire 1,500 acres wetland delineated, we identified first off where the likely locations were for roads, for driveways, for home sites, and then we instructed Woodlot to go out and to identify the RP1, the RP2 wetlands, plus the various buffers that would have any effect on the location of those facilities. They also looked at the places along the roadways where there may be upgrades that may require a certain amount of wetland alteration. That information, of course, is still an ongoing process, and we'll get into the status of that as we go through the presentation. There is a rather lengthy narrative that goes along with this. I think that more than most projects like this, we felt that there was a lot of background that was needed to understand the family's intent, how we arrived at the location of all the individual house sites, and how we're meeting the terms of the ordinance. So we feel that there is a very complete package on record just to guide you as a lay board in understanding the various materials that are before you. The 44 drawings are broken down into a number of sub-drawings for each of the 10 major existing lots that are out there. There's first of all an overall plan, usually a 200 scale that shows the lot as it's presently configured. There's then also both a site plan and a subdivision plan. This is not normally done for this type of project. We felt, again, it was important that you have as much information as possible. One shows the location of the home sites, the existing conditions, the stone walls, the tree lines, things that really made a difference in locating the houses, or the house sites, I should say. The other plan shows the location of all the soils information that have been done by Al Frick Associates, the location of all the test pits, the location of the wetland buffers, and so forth. So by combining all this information, we feel that there's a very good layered approach to looking at the land use patterns on the property. And then at the end of this package of drawings, there is the beginning of the description of what we're doing to deal with some of the more technical elements of the project. And here's where we'd like to have a discussion of the completeness. Typically, and as those of you who are around for Dominguez Crossing know that for a preliminary subdivision application, the planning board's ordinances require that you have a set of road designs that are brought up to a certain level. That level is a very high level. It requires a great deal of information. It requires a lot of surveying, wetlands evaluation. It requires a lot of information that if the road gets changed, as we found in Dominguez Crossing, is information that basically is wasted information and wasted efforts. As you know, as from our earlier discussions, we feel that there's a lot of issues that need to be talked about in this project relative to road location, relative to road width, materials, grading, and so forth. We would like to have a thorough discussion on those type of issues before we went to all the effort to do the final engineering, really the preliminary engineering for the roads, the stormwater management, the drainage, and so forth. The approach that we're taking at this point, then, is that the diagrams that are in your package are truly preliminary level information. They are not pre-construction documents. They show an intent to make improvements in certain areas. We have shown typical cross sections. We've shown typical erosion control measures, sections for catch basins and culverts and so forth. We have not gotten to the point of being extremely specific, showing exactly where the road's going to be widened or exactly the size of the culverts. We feel that in order to come up with that information, we're going to need a lot more guidance from this board before we can advise our clients to proceed with that next level. We have reviewed, of course, that information with Steve Harding, the town's engineer. We believe that he's in agreement with us in that level of detail, at least at this particular point in the application process. In reviewing the information that was that came back from Steve, he had a number of comments relative to the package that we have given to the planning board. First of all, is the design of the roads. As I said, this is not your typical project. We are going to be giving you, and we would like to do it as part of the final subdivision application, the final design of all the roads, the final design for storm drainage, the grading, and so forth. The approach we've taken for the on-site septic system has taken the same tact. This is, as we've said all along, an incremental family subdivision. This is not going to be a subdivision that is going to be offered on the open market. We're not expecting to see houses start popping up here rapidly over the next several years. And we have located, through the work of Al Frick, at least one site on each of the 40 new house sites have been identified, locations that he feels are confident that would support an on-site septic system. We have the HHE 200 form for each of these 40 sites. We have done, I believe, over 100 test pits throughout the entire area in terms of developing the sites for the septic systems as well as doing the soils mapping. And one of the things that we would like to discuss with the board is how we handle the issue of dealing with the whole application process for a septic system design. Our position is that we would like to identify the site on each of the lots that are suitable for on-site septic systems, and that when and if a site is going to be built upon, that the applicant, probably the Spray Corporation, would come before the code enforcement officer with the completed HHE 200 form, and that may be next year, it may be 20 years from now. And we don't know if the application forms or the required information will change at that point, But when the building permit was drawn, was applied for, then the current copy of the HHE 200 we presented to the town. There was a comment in Steve's review letter about the tract boundary survey. There is a lot of surveying that has gone into the development of this plan, as you can well be aware of. That information was done by BH2M, picks up on earlier surveys that were done over the course of the last several generations, and that information has been included in the layout of all the lots and is on the individual sheets for each of the 10 existing lots. Stormwater management plan is again a piece of information that normally is included as part of the preliminary subdivision application package. We do have a conceptual approach that has been presented by Lester Berry, PE, from BH2M, that shows generally how stormwater management is going to be handled on the property. Again, this is a relative island. There aren't any downstream property owners who would be affected by the development on here, as sparse as it is. We will be, as we develop the plans for the roadways, showing how culverts will be located and sized, the location of ditches, any minor amount of on-site detention that may have to be installed will be included in those subsequent plans that will be presented to the planning board. We'll probably be looking at some level of resource protection permit. Again, at this point, the intent, as Seth said throughout all of our planning, has been to minimize wetland impacts, to minimize disturbance of any soils, wetlands, natural resources that are on the property. And I don't want to repeat that often enough, but in laying out the cross-country roads, the interconnections here, one of the factors that we're trying to do is to minimize the amount of wetlands that will be filled or disturbed as we complete the loop road system. Again, at this point, we don't know how much wetlands will be disturbed. We'd like to think that that's going to be a minimal amount of wetland disturbance, hopefully under 10,000 square feet. And one of the next things that we're going to have to do in the whole cycle of getting this approved, both at the local, state, and the federal level, is to start dealing with those wetland alteration permits. Before we do that, we need to have a definitive answer on the road standards that we're going to be abiding by. And so one of the first things that we would certainly like to talk with the planning board about once the application is deemed complete is dealing with the road standard. Because once we have the road standards down, we will then be able to go back and do an accurate job of locating the amount of wetlands that will be affected by the development of the property. And last thing that we realize will be included as part of the final application process is a detailed description of all the wetlands, both adjacent to the individual home sites and those that may be affected by the construction of any new roads or any expansion of existing roads on the property. Just to repeat a couple of points that Seth has started, this is an incremental development. It's going to be something which is going to happen over many, many generations. We don't know how long it's going to be before you see full build out, and chances are it'll never be fully built out. We have no way of knowing, though, just what the pace of development may be like out here. We feel that everything that is being done here is totally in conformance with the comprehensive plan. The whole question of visual impact, of minimizing changes to the natural environment, leaving stone walls and small-scale roads and large trees and wetlands intact, which has been talked about throughout the comprehensive plan and on into the zoning ordinance and the road design standards, are the guiding points that we're using in the layout of the overall master plan for the family land use plan, as well as the layout of the design of the individual roads. This is an unusual situation for us as landscape architects. It's rare that we find a family who will be actually living on the property that is being subdivided, to use that term generically, acting as the client, acting as the developer. This is certainly a much different situation than the last time we appeared before the planning board for Dominicus Crossing. We certainly don't want to draw any comparison between the two, and hopefully it'll be the last time we even suggest that there is a comparison. There is no public access beyond the public roadways that are out there right now. That's something that, that Seth has talked about throughout here also. And finally, there will be minimal changes to the visual environment. There will be six new homes built off of a new road called Ice Pond Road off of Bowery Beach Road. But beyond that, the public that drives down Fowler Road may see an occasional house tucked on the top of a ridgeline or on the backside of a field. But the intent throughout here is to minimize the change that the public is used to as they come down through the property on the public roads or drive along the Bowery Beach Road. Well, there's certainly a lot more that we could say at this point, but I would like to, since it is getting late, to have that discussion on completeness at this point.
Thank you. As an overview to begin the review of completeness of the plans, I think probably the best thing to start with would be have Maureen review our item by item, the submission requirements and the status under this application.
Just to remind the board, there was a discussion at the workshop about going with the concept plan level and then getting the very detailed drawings later on. In going through and doing this completeness review, I did not reflect your discussion. So you're getting the complete overview of what's missing, and then you can insert over that how much of that you expect to be on a concept plan and how much you're willing to let go till the final plan. But starting with the subdivision review on 8A, culverts and drainage areas, the actual sizing and the construction of the culverts has not been designed at this time. That goes along with the concept plan. But the town engineer has also requested additional information regarding drainage areas. He spoke maybe just having some arrows and some general conceptual ideas about how they're planning to deal with drainage beyond the we're not planning to create a problem stage. Under water supply, typically this is not a primary issue for the planning board, because whenever you're reviewing a subdivision, there's a public water line that goes in, so this is kind of a sleeper issue that gets dealt with. This particular application is different. There is no public water, except for a couple of locations. There's no public water proposed for this development. So the applicant has submitted a water availability analysis, which is basically supposed to show that there's adequate water available to serve each individual lot. The problem is that the water report was done a couple of years ago, and the lot numbers have changed since then, and the designation of the roads, the applicant's done an excellent job of naming the roads, but the water supply report reflects letters of roads instead of names, so it's almost impossible to match it up. And the suggestion here is that at a minimum, that water supply report should be at least reformatted so it talks about the lot numbers as they're currently shown on the plan. Under hydrant locations, the fire chief has talked about the need for some dry hydrant maintenance and access needs. In addition, the town engineer has suggested that it might be very useful to have an overall plan that shows the fire protection plan, where the ponds are, where the dry hydrants are. This is very similar to a plan that was done for Dominicus Crossing, where there was an overall plan that showed, I think, hydrants and lighting and a few more things. But this is one of those subjects that really may be best reviewed at a large scale, the whole system all at once, as opposed to the 40 different sheets. Subsurface disposal, number 9. Typically, the planning board has required completed HHE 200 forms, which requires 5 test pits per form. The board may not want to have a whole bunch of holes dug out here for lots it won't be constructed on for any length of time, and the applicant has dug one test pit for every lot and submitted the logs for that one test pit, showing that at a very basic level that there is at least some suggestion that there's a place on each lot for a septic system. So the board will have to decide whether they're willing to accept that at this stage. The applicant has suggested that they would do the completed form when they apply for a building permit for that specific lot. Street and sidewalk data. Obviously, the applicant has not done grading and road profiles at this time, and probably it doesn't make a lot of sense to do those until there's been firm decisions made on how wide the roads are going to be. One other suggestion the board may want to think about is to have, again, an overall plan, maybe the same plan you're doing the hydrants and the water ponds, that shows the width of the roads all at once so you can get a view of the circulation plan for the whole development in one glance instead of flipping through the different pages. On the number 12C, lot-by-lot soil suitability analysis, is really a repetition of number 9 on the subsurface disposal. 13A, I may have missed it, but I didn't see a survey of the entire site stamped by a registered main surveyor. And this is a requirement of the subdivision ordinance, and the board will have to decide how they want to handle it on this particular development. The stormwater management plan, again, has not been submitted at this time, but that does tend to be a very detailed plan, which is very dependent on where you put roads, ponds, and things. And that's it for the subdivision. Would you like me to continue with the resource protection permit?
Please.
Okay. Under the resource protection permit, under item 5, the applicant has requested that vegetative information be submitted at a later date. Typically, for a resource protection permit, the board, the requirement is that you have to provide soils information, vegetation information, and hydrology. And the board routinely waives either soils or vegetation because one tends to be a determining factor on where the wetlands are. The applicant has submitted soils information, and it wouldn't be unusual to waive the requirement for information about vegetation. There has been a note under hydrology that a few ponds are missing from the plans, and that's probably more critical as a fire protection issue than as a resource protection issue. And then finally, under amendment to a previously approved subdivision, this is part of a subdivision that was approved by the planning board in 1983. And originally, I believe there were 18 lots. And some of them are on the north side of Bowery Beach Road. At a minimum, the applicant will need to, at some point, provide a subdivision plat that can be signed by the planning board. The plat has to have the book and page information of the previously recorded subdivision. And the board may want to think about whether it might be useful as a reference to have a copy of the original subdivision plat so that you could see where you were prior to 1983. So that's all I have for this moment. Are there any questions?
Given the fact that we have new board members, I think perhaps, and even for me, it would be enlightening the process through which a subdivision plan is sort of undertaken at the board is a two-step process. It involves the preliminary application, which we're being presented with tonight, which is approved. And then subsequent, usually I believe, subsequent to final DEP and environmental permitting being done, a second final approval. What we're being presented here this evening, I believe, takes the approach that we can take some of the information which in other cases we may have seen at the preliminary approval level that's more technically detailed and focus more on the overall scope of work issues, what is happening on the face of the earth. And then when those issues have been resolved, the technical backup will come back to us in the final subdivision approval phase. Now exactly, you know, which items are due in which phase, I'm not sure we really need to go exhaustively through that, but if there's anything I've gotten wrong in this, no, I'd appreciate knowing.
No, it was the experience of the board and of the consultants on this project that on the Dominicus Crossing project, the original submission was as large as this right now, and then the applicant did plan and profile drawings and then had to move or relocate some of the roads. And at that point, it seemed a good idea to make some of those major decisions about where roads ought to be before requiring an applicant to do the heavy design work. That doesn't mean that once the heavy design work comes in that you cannot still tinker and tweak things to make them fit. But it made a lot more sense to have a general sense of where you were before you went into the heavy engineering drawings portion of the review. Are there any questions about the procedure involved? I guess one other thing I'd like to say about completeness is that completeness is important for a couple of reasons. The board in the past has always tried to make the distinction between completeness and adequacy. An application may have all the information submitted that is needed for review, but you may not be happy with the information. It may not be adequate to meet the standards of review. Completeness is important because the board should not be discussing the substance of an application until they deem the application complete, and that's according to several state court decisions. Once you deem an application complete, it's a pending application under the current ordinances, and a clock starts ticking. At that point, the board starts on a clock where you have to hold a public hearing within a certain period of time, and then you are then confronted with making a decision within a certain period of time, unless you and the applicant mutually agree to continue or table the item to the following month. So it's an important step. It's one you have to take before you can get into the meat of an application.
Mr. Parkhurst.
With all that introduction, I'd like to make a motion.
Yes.
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that, based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Sprague Corporation for major subdivision review, resource protection permit, and private access waivers for the 60-plus or minus lot Sprague Master subdivision plan located south of Bowery Beach Road be deemed complete.
Mr. Wilcox, I'd like to second the motion.
We have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion?
Before we, the next item that seems to come up after this would be a public hearing for the next meeting. It seems to me that's too soon. I don't know if we have to do it then, but it seems like it's not going to serve anyone well to do it this soon without some more specifics being.
Would it be possible to come back for you as an intermediate step in a workshop session?
I think that would be possible. I think all members of the board would be interested in seeing where the work is going to happen on the face of the earth. The narrative, I think, gives us all the idea of what you want to do, but where roads are narrowed for wetland crossings, where roads are wider, you know, what is happening on the face of the earth is not there.
Yeah, it really almost demands a whole meeting just to
the ideas,
focus.
The ideas are there, and I think, you know, it's something where I think Mr. Parker's question reflects that.
The other thing, I really think it's critical now that we have three new board members that they get out to the site. And I think it's probably all the roadways are passable at this point. Because without that, I mean, they're just going to be lost. It almost seems like we need to do that before we do a workshop, before we do a public hearing. I mean, it seemed like we have to put the, I'm not sure which order, the chicken or the egg, but it's got to be in the right order, or else it's not going to make sense, and it's not going to serve anyone well. That, do we have to have a public hearing next meeting?
Well, as I stated, it puts you on a clock, and that's the clock. The ordinance states that within 30 days of its determination that a subdivision application is complete, the board shall hold a public hearing on such application.
Okay, that means it sounds like we need to have a site visit and a workshop before the next meeting. How is that going to work for the whole board members, all the board members?
Or possibly we should vote your proposal, your motion down, and deem the application incomplete and do what needs to be done.
With the clock that starts ticking, how long a period of time is it?
First of all, if you deem the application, you shouldn't be deeming an application incomplete because of timing issues. Let's make that clear.
What?
You shouldn't be deeming it incomplete because of timing issues. If you deem an application incomplete, you need to identify information that you expect the applicant to provide in order to make it complete. And you can use recommendations from staff, and you can refer to those. You can come up with your own list, as long as it has some relation to the submission requirements in the subdivision ordinance. But if you deem it incomplete, you've got to state what you think needs to be submitted to make it complete. If you deem it complete, you are then on a time clock where within 30 days, you have to hold a public hearing. You have to give the public an opportunity to be heard on the application. Typically, what the board does and what the ordinance requires is that as soon as you deem it complete, you schedule a sidewalk. What the new wrinkle you're talking about is coming back for a workshop. Typically, at this level, the applicant doesn't jump back into a workshop unless you've got a very tight, specific issue to deal with. And that's almost impossible to work into this time frame. After you hold the public hearing, you've got another 30 days, and then you have to make determination of approval on this application unless the applicant agrees with you to table the project.
Can we ask the public hearing be postponed?
The ordinance says 30 days. And I believe that's also part of state law. I don't have the, yeah.
So that sounds like the critical thing to get done now is to have a site visit for the board members. The workshop isn't as important.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
We have here that staff has prepared a summary of potentially incomplete items on the second page of her memorandum. And perhaps I might suggest that we might go through those and see which ones we're okay on accepting a concept and not the the details, and what things we really aren't willing to do that on that we do think needs to be developed before completeness is determined.
Okay, I think that's a good idea.
Would that be a good idea?
Yeah.
Okay. Is there a problem in going from deeming as complete and then starting the substantive review and having the public hearing, and then at that point, if we have to postpone final decision, we would do it on a month-by-month basis?
Well, I believe that if a public hearing is to be held, the public should have access to that complete information also, if they need to make comment on it. And until the board sees that information, I'm not sure how the public can see that information. And the mechanism by which that information would arrive and then become part of the application package at Town Hall here, I'm not sure how the timing would work on something like that.
When you say that information, are you talking about the items that Maureen has checked on?
Well, I think it's probably a good idea if we did go down through this, because there are physical things which need to be shown before we know what the work on the face of the earth is and not just the intention. So if we went down through those, I think we could all try to come to grips with whether or not the goal is enough for us to go on for a month, or whether we need to know the actual what's actually happening.
Okay. Want me to do this?
Would you like me to do it?
Okay.
I guess before we embark on this list of things that need to be done, I think we need to go back to the beginning of this discussion and realize that you glance through this list very quickly. I don't think there's anything here that doesn't fall into the category that details are going to come later, simply because it's a waste of money and waste of effort to do things now without having some substantive review at later meetings. And there are some things that shouldn't be done now because they might not need to be done. And like the HHE 200s, 40 years from now, if all of a sudden the last lot is being built on, God knows what we're going to have for state requirements at that point in time. And the technology that's going to be there for septic systems may be so far beyond what we even could possibly imagine now. Again, it's a waste of money and effort to do it now. And you look
but we might not feel that way about every single one of these. Some we might be willing to put off.
Okay, I just had to bring that up.
Yeah, I agree with that, but the only way to tell is probably, and within each category, there may be some information that everyone agrees on is not necessary, and because it's so technically detailed that it can't wait. But let's just sort of go down through the ones that have come to light on page two. 8B, culverts and drainage areas. If we're talking about a concept where final grading and runoff is not determined until the sort of general approach and impacts are pinned down, then this is one which we wouldn't be able to do at this point in time, and does not seem to be much of a problem, at least to me. How do anybody else have a feeling on this? Okay, 8C, water supply. A discrepancy in designation of lots from a report which is 2 years old to the present. Again, it doesn't seem to be something that is beyond comprehension at this point. 8D, hydrant locations. The fire chief has commented about dry hydrant maintenance and access needs. Does anybody have any feelings about the completeness of the fire protection plan presented in this package?
Going back to 8C, it doesn't seem that we'd be asking too much to update the information on water supply. And that depicting fire ponds, it seems to me somewhere, well, it's right here. It said it also appears that some of the fire ponds may not be depicted on the plan.
I think that they just weren't labeled.
I beg your pardon?
I think the problem is that they weren't labeled. This plan right here is a compilation of all the information that you have. We've simply colored them blue and put the label on them. I think that trout pond, for example, may not have had the label trout pond on it. It was described in our narrative, but it may not have been shown on the plans.
Yeah, I spent two nights and I couldn't find trout pond or seasonal pond. Trout pond I could tell was off the detail sheet, and seasonal pond made me wonder if it just wasn't there when it was surveyed because it's seasonal.
There's actually two places called seasonal pond.
Yeah.
And this is the one we're talking about.
And that's the one up there. Okay.
Is a seasonal pond a fire pond?
Yes. There's a hydrant out there right now.
What happens when it dries up?
Well, that's part of the fire pond protection plan. That will be changes made to some of these ponds where necessary to deepen them, to widen them, to upgrade the size of the dry hydrant.
Okay. Oh. What about the numbering and lettering of lots and roads in the 1996 concept?
You mean for the water supply?
Yeah, underwater supply.
Yes, we will be doing that as
that
part
can,
of our...
That can be done easily.
Very easily, yes.
Yeah. So we could ask for that.
Yeah.
Couldn't we?
Doesn't that make sense to have that done when the maps are made more detailed and more specific? It doesn't seem to be that important at this point in time.
Yeah, the intent of that report was to show generally that there's adequate water out here, not on an individual lot-by-lot basis, and I think that's what the report shows.
Okay. I find You know, frankly, as a new member of this board, I just find this whole process very frustrating and confusing, because I think the point was made when you ask the public to comment on a plan that's not finished, there's something missing. It's not fair.
Well, I thought that we had a discussion with the board in workshop about this concept.
I understand that,
yeah.
And I do understand why you want to do it.
Yeah. And that's the reason that we approached it in this fashion.
Yeah. But I think, you know, the board has to grapple with this because it's something new and different.
Mr. Parkhurst.
I think the other thing that you're going to see, very simply, this subdivision is not going to be offered to sale to the public. There are virtually no neighbors. I think there may be some people that come to the meeting just because they're interested, but I don't think anyone's really going to have much to comment about, because it really doesn't have any base, you know, any bearing on it.
It's my understanding also the public would have an opportunity to comment in a final public hearing at the time of final subdivision approval. Mm-hmm. At that point, all the details will be worked out.
We are free to have another public hearing later on in the process.
Okay, well, let's proceed to item 8D, hydrant locations. Is the plan presented for which ponds are to be used for fire protection complete? Enough for us to just understand it. Does anybody have a...
Mr. Wilcox?
Opinion of that? Yes, Mr. Carter.
I believe the ongoing negotiations, if you will, between the applicant and the fire chief still have a lot of work remaining. And I simply have a comment, and it's a personal opinion, based on working with the chief on other matters before the board in the past and meeting with him as an individual when I happen to catch him in town. I've concluded that perhaps in fire protection, protecting your property and prevention of fires is his first priority, but in the event of an actual fire breaking out, that's not his first priority. His first priority in the event of an actual fire is protecting the lives of the firefighters who show up at the scene of the fire. And with that in mind, I ask that you continue negotiating and working with the fire chief and perhaps leaning a little bit towards his side of the argument. It's not your property that we're concerned about. It's the lives of the firefighters who show up at the scene of the fire.
I think to address the question of completeness, the fire chief has started to review. I think that we've seen an initial letter back from the chief, and I think that he's used the information that we've given so far and his knowledge, his personal knowledge of the site, to make the comment. So I think in terms of the fire chief's level of information, we've given him enough so he can start his initial review. I agree with Mr. Carter that we will continue a strong dialogue with the chief to arrive at a mutually satisfactory solution towards the issue.
However, I feel at this point in the application process that it shouldn't be held up because of this. I just wanted to make the point that it was an important item.
Yeah, we would like the clock to start ticking before we really start those discussions in earnest with the chief.
I also feel the point that was just made earlier, we have the opportunity to have two public hearings. Because this is property that, as Mr. Parkhurst mentioned, will never be sold, it's not a for-profit application, if you will. And because of the size of the buffer area, if you will, I don't see the public having a great number of comments or fears or concerns in this matter. So I don't see the need for a second public hearing, but it's nice to know we have it if in the end the application changes substantially. We have that opportunity to bring that information back before the public.
Mr. Mr. Dewan, I noticed on the plans that the fire pond on Lot 6 was the only one which actually showed a new dry hydrant and new piping from the dry hydrant up to the road. At this point in time, do you have any ideas as to whether or not there would be other new dry hydrants added on other plans?
We did talk about relocating the one in Japanese Pond and this end to that end down there.
And maintenance of a couple others.
And then there's a maintenance schedule for all the other ones that we're showing.
So at this point in time, is the new dry hydrant on Lot 6 Pond
Green Pond
the only one that you're envisioning adding?
We're talking about as a new dry hydrant.
That would be the only new one?
Yes.
Okay. Well, let's move on to number 9, the subsurface sewage disposal system data. Again, this is one which has sort of a phased approach. We have an indication of soils that will support septic systems and not
I'm okay with
final
that
designs. Does anybody
that's
think
fine.
That's okay? Number 10A, street and sidewalk data. This is a concept whereby the actual details of fills and side slopes and cuts and fills for the roads, which is really a sort of an inch by inch down the length of the road sort of affair, that would happen during the final approval phase and not the preliminary approval phase. Does anybody have any concerns about that?
Well, somewhere along the line, we're really going to have to grapple with the problem of the width of the roads, because we have a couple of letters that are very much opposed to the narrow widths that you are proposing. And having lived for 35 years in Delano Park, I understand what those narrow roads are like. I know how hard they are to keep up in the winter when the snow just, on a bad snow year. So I'm concerned about that issue.
It's probably the best thing to do, though, is to look at the solutions, the possible solutions out in the field, to envision what 14, 16, 18,
yes.
20 feet looks
yeah.
like, to talk with
yeah.
people that do the maintenance, to look at emergency access versus full-time year-round roads. And that's really the approach that we're taking, is that the loop road really needs to be looked at almost on a foot-by-foot basis. And we're not asking you to help us design it, but we really need to have some understanding of what the guiding principles are. And we've suggested an approach, but it's probably the best thing, though, to look at it in the field.
Mr. Dewan, at this point, the narrative describes the loop road as being sort of improved to varying extents depending upon the wetland considerations that are found
and other considerations, right.
But at this point in time, do you know where those wetland areas are?
We have had wetland survey done. I can't say exactly right now just where those areas are, but we've started to indicate that information on the plans that you have.
Okay, well the plans that we have described that from, you know, one point for so many thousand feet to another point, it will vary. It will be 18 feet here where it's dry, it'll be 14 feet where it's wet, regardless of, you know, whether it's 14 feet or 15 feet or 13 feet. Do you know where those 14-foot sections are?
What we did is walked out in the field again with the GPS units, and we said starting at this station, going to that station, the road should really be 14 feet.
Okay.
For these reasons.
Okay. You have that information now? It's not on the plans we received.
Correct. Right. We have that information for the majority of the emergency loop road. The wetland delineation is preliminary at this point because it was done during the winter time.
Okay.
It's not a full wetland delineation that will be done know, it's the project being done this time.
Okay.
We have a good idea where they are.
Yeah, because from the plans we've gotten so far, we don't know whether there's more 14 and less 18, or vice versa. There's no way of knowing how much of each there is or where it is. The next item is the lot-by-lot soil suitability analysis, which is part of the general soils information that we already discussed. Item 13A is the tract boundary line survey. Does anybody have a comment to make on how that...
There should be a tract boundary survey on file already that was approved as part of the 1983.
Right, right.
No? I have not seen it, but I would assume...
Have I?
But it seems to me we should have that.
Yep.
It's submitted to the registry. We have it submitted to the registry in 1983. Approved subdivision is in the registry of deeds and can be supplied to you. That can be given at any time.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. The next item is the stormwater management plan. No details or cross-sections. Again, this sounds like the sort of, this is again another instance of whether we review it now or review it later.
Yeah.
Sort of thing. Does anybody have a...
Are the culverts and drainage areas and the stormwater water management plan connected with the roads?
In this particular case, yes.
Yeah.
In a larger subdivision, where you had concentrated houses, you may have detention basins and other measures, but we're not planning on that sort of structural approach to stormwater management here.
The beginnings, the stormwater plans which we received, which show basically the major watersheds, has that given you enough information at this point in time so that you know if there are roads which would need to be culverted as part of expanding them? Is that the type of information that would be sort of before us at a workshop if we needed to look at it?
Existing roads have culverts in them, and I would essentially think that the improvements would occur at those
same locations.
Just on a better level of engineering.
Mm-hmm.
We could certainly bring Les Berry to address those kind of detailed issues at a public hearing if he feels necessary.
Okay. Under the resource protection permit, the vegetative cover, item number 5, given the fact that we have received some soils information, does anybody have an opinion about that? Seems fairly.
Do we have adequate soils information?
We have high-intensity soils information for the lots.
On the sheets, there is some soil information, but that wouldn't really indicate vegetative cover, would it, necessarily?
That's part, again, it's part of the work that Woodlawn Alternatives is doing to identify the edges of the wetlands and the wetland buffers relative to the improvements made to the roads.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this is all part of that domino effect that we're looking at. Once we get the road design done, then we'll get the final wetlands work done.
Mr. Duane, I had another question on the roads. The geotechnical report referenced a high water table and poor soil conditions in the vicinity of a few of the roads, and then went on to detail that you know, best engineering practices in such conditions would be under-draining or a fairly extensive work program in areas like that. Have you at this point in time sort of analyzed all of that and decided on how extensive a road...
No, any under-drainage work, any depth of gravel, any of the technical details would be submitted as part of the you know, preliminary or the final engineering done for the road.
That would be based upon additional site observations by BH2N and the soils information that has been collected so far.
And so those would most likely then also be confined to these areas where you know there would need to be work done.
That's correct.
And they would not cause sort of ripple effects going into other parts of the site. Okay. Note number 8, a few ponds are missing from the plans.
But you said they were in the narrative.
They are in the narrative, and the fire chief was able to locate them.
And this is, and the final item is that since this is an amendment to a previously approved subdivision, we will work off of the original subdivision plat at some point. Okay. Well. Does anybody have any more comments regarding the completeness?
I think it's time to take a vote.
Okay.
Your motion wasn't seconded.
Yes, it was.
Yeah, Mr. Carter has seconded the motion. We have a seconded motion. No further discussion. All those in favor of the application being deemed complete, please raise your right hand. All those in favor of it being deemed incomplete, raise your right hand. Just me. Okay. We now have a complete application.
Not happy. Not happy.
Can I make one last comment?
Surely.
You need to make another motion anyway.
Excuse me?
You need to make another motion.
Oh, I'd be happy to do that one. I think we can't lose sight of the fact that this is a family subdivision. This family is coming before us to try to make life easier for everyone, and I don't think we need to really make it difficult for them to get to where they want to go.
I certainly do not, if you're referring to me. I certainly
no.
don't. I do understand that it's a private area, but I do also think that the town is responsible for the public health, safety, and welfare of the people who live there. So we do have a responsibility.
Well, I don't want to get into a discussion about that. If someone decides they want to build a house there, they know what the limitations are on the fire protection, given what's there. That's their choice. Frankly, you know, it's their decision to make. But anyway, that being said, I'd like to make another motion to adjourn the meeting. No?
One more motion.
We're going to pump it soon. Oh. And motion for the board to consider, be it further ordered, that the application be tabled to the regular April 21st, 1998 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Second.
Your second? Second. Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor, raise your right hand. Motion passes unanimously. Well,
make
you're complete.
Motion.
Site walk?
Yes. In particular, would it be a good idea to have a site walk?
Yep.
And a good time? Quite frequently, we do these for the information of the new members on the board. We do these quite frequently on early on the weekend, on a Saturday morning, for instance. As we get on into the spring and summertime, there's sometimes enough time in the evening after work, starting at 5:30, but I don't think we're quite into that much daylight yet. That being said, some Saturday between now and the workshop on April 7th, and if we just sort of look at our, just in general, is anybody out of town on the 21st of March? And, how about the 28th of March?
Which day? Are we shooting for a date yet?
Looking for, early Saturday morning sort of thing, March 28th.
Fine.
Is that okay?
I'm in Nashville.
You're not here. Okay.
April
4th?
Yep.
Okay. That was a yes,
so
that
one. What are we talking? 28th or the 4th?
April 4th.
4-4.
4-4? Early in the morning?
Not too early.
Not
yeah,
too
let's
early?
Do it early in the morning.
Early is good.
Early is good.
It's 7?
7. Whoa. No, 7's.
7:20.
I need my coffee. Does 8 o'clock sound reasonable?
8.
8 would be good.
8.
8 o'clock. And
does Maureen drive the bus again?
Maybe it won't be snowing.
20 years ago this year, on April 4th, we had a major snow.
I remember that.
Oh, no.
And we'll meet behind Town Hall.
Yes. Yeah.
The Conservation Commission also had expressed the desire to tag along.
And where are we going to meet?
Behind Town Hall. 8 a.m.
4-4.
And how long do you think this will take?
How long do you want to take?
It took about 2 hours last time.
Yeah, 2 hours.
That's a max.
Yeah.
Right. We didn't know the truck at all.
We had scheduled 4 hours the last time we did it in twos.
It was snowing pretty hard.
That's right.
You want to take 2-3 hours?
Two. That's
two. Yeah. Do we want to concentrate on a particular issue like roads, emergency access, or do you want to get more of an overview?
Overview.
Roads.
Yeah, I wanna see these famous roads.
An overview would just, you know, some time spent on the 4 or 5 items in the store.
Okay. Right. 2 hours, we can do it.
Okay.
Okay.
With that, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Yep.